Merci. Non, j'ai pas sorti les dossiers, Gilles. On va les sortir peut-être à un autre moment. En tout cas, merci de nous réunir. Je suis très, très content d'être là pour te rendre hommage. Alors, c'est vrai que j'ai quelques photos. Je pense que on peut parler un peu de. Évidemment, on était en contact depuis longtemps. Moi, tu as été mon prof. À Paris 6, Paris 7, il y a très longtemps, sur l'arrêt optimal et des choses comme ça, donc ça rigolait pas. Et puis après, en thèse, en fait, si je me rappelle bien, tu organisais les journées des jeunes probabilistes à Aussois. Voilà, donc c'était aussi un moment d'échange où j'étais avec Benjamin, je me rappelle, voilà. Oui, voilà. Tu t'en rappelles. Et donc, c'était vraiment un moment super parce que c'est vrai qu'on voyait bien que tu aimais passer du temps avec les jeunes et partager. Et voilà, ça, c'est quelque chose qui te caractérise. Tu es aussi caractérisé par une énergie débordante, toujours la formule bien choisie. Et donc, ça, on est ravis, évidemment. On a déjà souligné tous ton efficacité dans la gestion des masters, des conférences et autres, et c'est remarquable, et je pense qu'on est ravis d'être là. Alors, évidemment, là, on parle un peu de science aussi. Donc, je me suis demandé un peu ce que j'allais pouvoir présenter. Et je pense que tu fais partie de ces personnes qui, il y a longtemps, ont travaillé sur les réseaux de neurones. À l'époque, tout le monde s'en foutait, si je peux me permettre. Et puis, voilà. Et puis maintenant, c'est devenu des choses plus importantes. Donc, je me suis dit, de quoi je peux parler? De toute façon, Gilles, tu as tellement adressé de sujets, comme disait Eric tout à l'heure, ou Denis tout à l'heure, entre les algostos, les discrétisations dans tous les sens, les schémas multilevel, les lois invariantes, les quantifications et autres. Bon, voilà, c'est énorme. Donc, c'est vraiment un spectre large, très large. Donc, je me suis dit que parler de réseaux de neurones, de processus gaussien, ce serait pas mal. Puis on connaît aussi tes capacités, ton expertise à décortiquer les problèmes sur les taux de convergence, etc. Donc je me suis dit qu'un résultat, un exposé sur les taux de convergence un peu fin, peut-être, enfin j'espère, avec du gaussien, avec des réseaux de neurones, ça pouvait peut-être bien correspondre à tes centres d'intérêt. Voilà, peut-être que tu vas trouver tout ça peut-être très évident, tout à fait standard, mais en tout cas j'espère que tu vas apprécier. Bon, I'm going to switch to English for the talk. So I'm going to present this joint work with Mickey Lellouche is here and Stéphane Girard from Grenoble about how to generate a fractional brain and motion with a ReLU network, neural network. So initially we wanted to consider the problem of we were just curious about the capacity of a neural network to generate complex objects. Okay, so complex objects, for me, this is something like an infinite-dimensional object, like a stochastic path. So I was just wondering, okay, how is it possible that a neural network can generate a stochastic path, a quite complex stochastic path? Okay. So it was the starting point of the thing. And indeed, it may have some interest in practice because you know that some models are really difficult to simulate. At least it takes time to generate a path because you are very clever to do this. But okay, at the end, it takes some time to generate one path. And so just learning a kind of meta model or numerical twin once you have some sample path, and this numerical twin is made of neural network, quite easy to use, it has some interest. And so we were wondering about, okay, which model to start with. And so we thought that brain motion could be a starting point. And at the end, we come up with a fractional brain motion because, you know, it is quite irregular. There's a parameter describing the path irregularity. There's no Markovian property. Okay, so it's not that complicated, but you can not take advantage of Markovianity or martingales or something like this. So we started with fractional random motion. Okay, and so the point is try to, try to find a neural network based generative model for simulating the full path of fractional motion, not only things at some time points, but really the full path. So really the kind of infinite dimensional object we have in mind. Okay, and usually, so of course, you can try. So I'm sure that many people try to do this. You just put some architecture for your neural network and try to optimize and try to see. But the question we wanted to ask is, apart trying to explore, investigate what kind of architecture or many neurons, try to give some theoretical support to say that if you take that amount of neurons, that amount of hidden layers, then there's a solution. There's a solution or accurate solution. Trying to find some, provide some theoretical result for supporting the use of neural network. Okay, so of course, you know fractional bundle motion. This is defined as a Gaussian center Gaussian process with that covariance. The case 1/2 corresponds to Brennan motion. The case H equal 1 is of course a bit degenerate because you have just this is quite simple. This is a straight line, a random straight line. So we're not going to consider this situation. And here this is a sample path of a fractional Brennan motion depending on the Earth's parameter H here. Okay. So indeed, we want to have a neural network able potentially able to generate this kind of path given a H. So I'm not going to generate a parametric neural network depending on H or conditional neural network, but I'm going for a given H, I'm going to try to see if we can find a neural network able to do this. So what is a generative model? I'm sure you know, but just to be pedagogical. So usually a generative model, this is a function going from what we call a latent space, so a space where you're going to simulate things. Imagine you're going to sample some independent uniform random variables or some Gaussian variables, okay? So this is your latent space, and it's going to map this latent space into the data space. So that is the path of Brennan motion, of fractional Brennan motion typically, okay? Or continuous path here. So you want to find this is a generative model that is a function going to from this latent space to the data space. And so typically what we want to find is a function G so that when you're going to feed the function G with some random inputs, Z, so Z could be quite general, okay, in dimension one, in dimension N, okay, then the distribution of G of Z has the same distribution as X, X being the path of your stochastic process, typically, okay. Okay, so we know that there exists some such a function, okay, in general. This is given by, for example, Kuratowski theorem. But the question is, there's not a unique solution. There are many possible solutions, okay? So the question we should ask, typically, is, okay, how to choose the latent dimension here, okay? So that is, I'm going to determine some random variable to generate. So how many, that is the N. What is the distribution of these coordinates, okay? That is the choice of mu. And then when I've chosen these, how to approximate the G, okay? And of course, you imagine that it has some interest to choose Zn so that the G has some good properties in terms of approximation. Okay, so this is the program we have. Try to provide a mu, a n, a g of a neural network type to generate fractional Brennan motion. So once you have a generative model, then you have to learn to help the model to learn the parametrization from a data set. Okay, so generally you start with a ID sample of data you want to mimic. So typically you have generated many fractional Brennan motion. Okay, so here this is written in RD, but it will be a continuous path in our case. Okay, so you have parameterized your generative model with some parameter theta, okay, going from the latent space to the data space, okay, and you want to find some optimal parameters here. Okay, and to do so, you there's a optimization, adversarial optimization. So there's a game between two things: optimizing the generative model, but with a discriminator which decide at the end if it is a fake data or if it is a true data. And at the end, the discriminator cannot distinguish between true and fake data. And so this is the framework of generative adversarial networks. So you have a data set here, okay, you want to learn from. You have a parameterization using a kind of neural network with some possible many hidden layers. And then there's an algorithm which at the end you try to minimize and maximize, so optimize the generative model, but optimize also the discriminator, so that at the end you can not distinguish between true and fake data. So this is the general story of GAN. And in our case of fractional motion, what we're going to add here is not only some random variable Z, but of course we want to add T as an input parameter, because we want to simulate a path. So at some point, T must be in the parameters we take as input. Okay, so we're going to compute some linear combination of these, apply some activation function like ReLUS, or the max between 0 and x here, and perhaps compose with many times. So at the end, we have a neural network parameterization. Okay, so here this is just one layer, but of course we'd like to we're wondering if multi-layer can help in this problem. Okay, so I'm going to start with the main result we have, and then I'm going to explain how it works. Okay, so you remember that there are different parameters entering in the definition of a generative model: the size of the latent space, the distribution in the latent space. Okay, so here I'm going to explain. So here I'm going to fix a latent space of dimension with dimension n, and n will goes to will be an accuracy parameter. So the larger the n, the more accurate the result we will have at the end. Okay. So what we say is that we're going to consider a parity space where we can generate n independent standard Gaussian random variables. Okay, so you have a dimension n, you simulate n independent coordinates with Gaussian distribution. Okay, and the result is the following. Then you can build an extension of this parity space supporting a Brendel motion BH. Okay, such that with some priority P. So P is supposed here, this is an accuracy, a kind of confidence parameter. So you expect that P is close to zero. Okay, so you want something to be very close to one. So P should be very close to zero. So for any confidence interval P, parameter by P, for any parameter, there's a free parameter R here, which is supposed to be large here, then you can find a deep ReLU neural network. So that is a function of the type of this type, but with many layers here. Okay, such that the difference between the output of your neural network feed with independent Gaussian distribution with T as an input parameter, the subnorm between this neural network output and your fractional bound motion, in subnorm, bounded by a constant terms, logarithmic terms divided by n to the h, so n is here an accuracy parameter, then this is greater than one minus p, and p should be close to one. And in addition, we can describe a bit what is the complexity or the architecture of this. In fact, this is made of this amount of hidden layers. So here, that amount of hidden layers and that amount of neurons and parameters. So perhaps this is a bit, this is the more accurate result, but It depends on the rho n parameter. Rho n, what is it? This is the quantile of the Gaussian distribution at the level p divided by 2n. So p goes to zero. Okay, so the quantile goes to here to infinity, to minus infinity. So this rho n will go to plus infinity. But because this is the quantile of the Gaussian function, we know that it goes to plus infinity at a square at a very small rate. So this is like a square root of a log, in fact. So this function here is like a square root of log of this. Okay. So very, it depends very slowly on p and n. So essentially, this rho n is like this term. Rho n here is like square root of log n. Typically, this is, if p is fixed, this is similar. So essentially, the take-home message here is that once you fix p, you can discard rho n divided by square root log n. So essentially, here you just have n. So the neural network we describe has a number of hidden layers proportional to log n. Okay. So if you want to have an accuracy of 1 over n to the h, you need log n hidden layers. So it's not that deep. It gets deeper and deeper when n increases, but it goes very slowly to infinity. And regarding this term here, well, this term and this term are the same. So here, this is essentially a constant. Here, this is just log n here. And this r can be taken as large as we want. So at the end, we have just n here. So at the end, the message is that here, the number of neurons and parameters we describing this neural network is like a big O of n log n, something like this. Okay. So this is the result for describing this neural network. So it doesn't mean that this is the best neural network. Maybe we can do better. Maybe we can remove this, I don't know. But with high priority, we can find a neural network doing this. And we don't have a lower bound for the complexity. I think it could be an interesting question, but we don't have any lower bound for the complexity. Okay, so the just to summarize the before diving in the proof, to summarize the thing is that if we fix an error tolerance we call tall, so it was n to the pi 1 over n to the h here, then the depth is like log of 1 over tall. Okay, this is the take home message, and the complexity is like tall to the power minus 1 over h, h being the time regularity. So I think this is something, when you look at the proof, this is something we hope to generalize to other stochastic process. If the time regularity is h, we guess that maybe we can find a deep a generative model with depth log 1 over tall and number of and complexity like tall to minus 1 over h parameters if h is the time regularity. Okay, so I'm going to explain then, I'm going to give the proof of this, at least the sketch of proof. I have to check the schedule. Okay. Okay, so first, the easy thing with a Gaussian process is that you can represent a Gaussian process. This is a general idea. Under this form, okay, it is a general result here. So you can still find some continuous non-random function, uk of t, okay, times some independent, a series of independent standard Gaussian one variable here. Okay, so there are many ways to write this. Okay, there's not a unique way to find such a representation. There are multiple ways. So the starting point is to find a good representation of a fractional Brownian motion or Brownian motion if h is equal to 1 half. Okay. Okay. So for the Brownian motion, The natural function we want to select is not necessarily the one we find with quantization, but this is it could be the at function, okay, the temp function. This is the Faber-Schroeder wavelet. So this is this function here, okay, and we know that indeed, if I can write an infinite sum here, just by choosing the UK shown before as this Faber wavelet function, properly scaled and properly shifted, okay, with independent Gaussian here, okay, and this is typically the Levy construction of Brownian motion. You can see here the animation here. Okay, so depending on the number of n here, you know the trick. We teach this in our master class. You pick the midpoint and then you enrich the path and so on and so on. Okay, so we can start with this first truncation here. Instead of having an infinite sum, I will truncate the infinite sum to just a finite sum. It will be my Levy construction of Brownian motion. Okay, and then the question is, okay, how can I generate these using a ReLU neural network? So you see that we are not far, because indeed, we make some linear transformation of the G here, and we're just wondering, is it possible to generate these with ReLU? In fact, the question is a bit trivial, because the at function is already a combination of three ReLU functions. Okay, so this part is easy. This function as a function of time, this is already a ReLU neural network with just three parameters. So this part is easy. The only thing we have to do is in fact to synthesize the product with neural network, because natively, neural network can't do a product, okay? A neural network just makes some linear combination of things, composition, but can't do product between quantities. So the only point is, okay, how do you do a product using a neural network? And then the proof will be over for the Brownian motion, which is not that interesting regarding the simulation, but this is just a toy example. Okay, so this is, I'm just summarizing. So indeed, when you truncate when you consider the Levy construction at rank n, the distance between your Brownian motion and the Levy construction, then you can quantify these almost surely. Okay, it's not that hard. There's a C which is random here, but there's you can quantify this distance. And indeed, the function psi I've shown before are just linear combination of the three neural networks. Three ReLU functions, sorry. And so at the end, we want to approximate this product. Okay. So which is not on the slide. So when you want to make a product, the naive thing to do is to use polarization formula. So once you make the product of A times B, what you're going to do is A plus B squared minus A minus B squared, okay, and gives you four times A times B, okay? So if you are able to make the square, then you are able to make the product. And so this is what we're going to do, how to make a square. In fact, in Yarotsky paper, 2017, there's a trick to make a product, to make the square with ReLU neural network. Okay, so there are many ways to do, but there's a way which use a deep neural network, which is very low, which is a low cost way to make a square. So typically the trick is the following. This is here. When you go, so psi here, psi is just the at function. Okay, psi is the at function. Yes, so when you compose j times the at function, so one times this is here, twice this is this, okay, and when you compose j times and then you just average and weights the result, you obtain a function HL, okay, and this function is simply a very, very accurate of the of the square here. Okay, and you can compute the accuracy in subnorm, the distance between the h is the square and your neural network is just like this. So you see that when you increase l, the number of hidden layers corresponding to the number of times you compose these, then you obtain something very accurate. So it's going to converge geometrically quickly. Okay, so very nice. But in fact, you should be aware also that this approximation is valid only on a compact interval. So if you apply this approximation, this construction outside 0,1, it doesn't work at all. Okay. If you apply this outside, for example, at x equal 2, it doesn't work at all. So this is accurate only on 0,1. Okay, so once you have on 0,1, it's not that hard to extend on -1,1 just by symmetry. Okay, because you just compose with the absolute value, which is easily done with a ReLU function. And at the end, to obtain the H2 function here, this is the architecture of the neural network you need. So you first use some ReLU function just to have the absolute value. And then you do this trick with equal to, and this corresponds to this. And so you see the number of parameter here is very small, in fact, for a very good accuracy at the end. Okay, and so there's a kind of result saying how to compute a product of tooth quantities. So we want to approximate k of xy, okay, by some neural network. And you want to approximate k of the product xy only for x and y smaller than n and b. Remember that you can rely only on approximation on a compact set, okay. So you can find a neural network able to approximate the product on the interval minus AA times minus BB with that accuracy, okay, and with a given complexity, so it corresponds to L plus one hidden layers. There's a number of parameters equivalent to big O of L, and that's it, okay? So this is an easy way to complete the proof for the Brennan motion. Just to summarize, okay, here remember what I want to do is I want to have a generative model for this using n Gaussian distribution. Okay, this is directly a ReLU neural network, very simple with three ReLU function. Then the product is made through the square, and the square I just need to use the previous function. The only thing is that this function is bounded, so it gives a bound on the A, on the A parameter, but the bound on the G are not don't have any deterministic bound on the G. Okay, so I just can apply the result with a given polarity. So it gives rise to the P in the result. Okay. So now I'm going to jump to the fractional Brennan motion. So in fact, we're going to apply the same routine. So we know that we can decompose the fractional Brennan motion as an infinite sum with product of determinist function times independent Gaussian distribution. But we want to find an accurate decomposition. Okay, so the decomposition we're going to use is the one by Meyer-Taku. Which is that one, okay? So we can represent a fractional motion like this as a double infinite sum using some psi h function defined here times, so with some, you see some parameter here, so j goes to minus infinity to plus infinity, so j describe the scaling, k describe the location, and with some independent Gaussian distribution here, the Gaussian random variable here, okay? And the psi h are related to the are described in its Fourier domain by this, and psi h here is the psi is the Le Marié-Meyer wavelet, which is described here, okay, explicitly, which has nice property is known in signal processing with some nice function new here I'm then going to describe. So if you choose accurately properly the new here, then you can validate this decomposition here. So Dobushi has some proposal for new. There are different proposition for this, but we can find some function so that we have this representation here. Okay, so what is the strategy? You imagine. First, approximate this with a ReLU neural network with T as the input parameter. Okay. Then apply the product trick. That is, we're going to synthesize the product using the square function. Okay. And then that's it. And then we have also to account which coefficient do we want to keep here? Okay, how to truncate the summation. So this is the first result. The first result is essentially due to IH. So it which says essentially that if you choose well the psi H function as shown before, so there's some condition, but we can satisfy the fulfill the condition. Then there's a way to select the double parameter J and K, so that you have this finite sum here, and the distance between the finite sum and the infinite sum is controlled like this, essentially like 1 over n to the h in subnorm. Okay. Okay, this is one part. So now we want to analyze. The complexity of a neural network for approximating this quantity. So we're going to start with that term here. So here it is a bit more complicated than before, because in the case of Brennan motion, this function here was just a linear combination of three ReLU functions. So the job was finished. Here we have to work a bit more, because we have to approximate this for any T, J, and K. So usually, when you use Brennan ReLU neural network, you know that you can rely on some approximation result on a compact set. Okay, Gilles, you worked much on this in your first paper, one of your first paper on neural network. Okay, so we could apply this. There's a kind of universal approximation theorem we could apply, but this is only on a compact set. Okay, so here we need to approximate this psi function with, of course, many j, many k, and of course it could be an infinity. So in fact, we need to approximate psi h on the full real line. Okay, so the strategy proof is not that hard. You see, on the picture is that the psi h, in fact, has some nice properties, is going to decrease very quickly at infinity. So essentially, the support of psi h is essentially compact. It's not exactly the case, but you understand the idea. Since it's going to decrease very quickly, then you can do the tricks you imagine, truncate on the compact, compute the tails, and approximate accurately in the bulk of the, at the center of the distribution, the points here. Okay. Indeed, we can prove that the derivative of the psi h function going to decrease very quickly as the parameter u goes to plus and minus infinity. And so I think here this is the technique you are using, Gilles, in one of your first paper on neural network. Okay, and I'm going to mention what is perhaps a bit new, okay, corresponding to that initial proof. Okay, so we want to prove that uniformly on R, we can approximate the psi function by a neural network. So the trick is quite easy. You just expand the function by local polynomial. Okay, quite easy. And localize local polynomial. Okay, so essentially, you come up with, you choose some grid with m points. Locally, on small interval, your function looks like a polynomial. You know that the psi h is very smooth. Okay, and that's it. The trick perhaps corresponds the new things here is the deepness property we want to use, is that in fact we know how to compute in a very deep and low-cost fashion this power function here. In fact, we want to replace this power here by a deep ReLU network with a small number of coefficients. Okay, so the way we're going to do is when you know to do the square, of course, you know to do the square, you know to do the product. So x to the 3 is just x times x squared. Okay. So once you do, you know how to do the square, you know the product, you know all the power of x, in fact. So this is the thing we're going to use to do in this proof. So generate this by a deep neural network with a small number of coefficients. Then we're going to compose with this formulation here, and at the end you obtain the proof. Okay, so I'm then just going to give the result. So typically here, okay. So here I'm just want to show the result we have. The small result is how to synthesize by neural network a power function y to the q or x y to the q. Okay, the result is that you can of course build by recursion this approximation of power here like this. Okay, and you can do this with a depth L. Okay, you have a depth L, and you have a number of you have a depth which is q minus one L to f plus one, and you have a number of neurons which essentially is proportional to L here. And the accuracy in doing so, you see that it depends on the size on the data you have, so the y and the x here. So this is just proportionality coefficient here, and here. When L gets large, then this term goes to zero. So this term is like up to constant this quantity here. So you see that when N gets large, then this term goes very quickly to zero. It goes even geometrically quick to zero. So it means with a small depth, you can have something very accurate. This is why we have at the end only log N depth for the neural network. And so this is the end of the talk. So just to summarize, so this is the result. So if you are fixing a tolerance for approximating your fractional brain motion, then you need a depth like log one over tall, and a complexity as number of parameters like n to the minus n tall to the power one minus h. And we think that this is a generative property. We guess that this is a generic property of for generative model for stochastic process. So depending on the time regularity of the process, we can find a similar architecture and complexity for a generative model. Bon anniversaire, Gilles.